program for four-year-olds. We are pleased to share that all applicants, 24, have been accepted to the three-year-old program. Future applicants for the three-year-old program will be added to a wait list in the order they are received. We have 10 applicants for the four-year-old lottery. All families have been notified of their number by the preschool coordinator, Kim Sullivan. At this time, we have three openings for the four-year-old program. Applicants beyond this will be added to a wait list based on the lottery sequence generated.
So how is the lottery going to work? We will be using the website random.org. With the click of a mouse, we will generate a list of numbers 1 through 10 randomly and produce this list in a single column format.
So that is what I am typing now.
Tomorrow, the numbers will be posted on the preschool website, and we will announce what we are doing as we actually plug in the numbers. So the sequence is plugged in, and we have our random list of numbers in order. They are 6, 10, 5, 2, 7, 1, 9, 3, 4, 8. Again, all your three-year-old applicants have been accepted for 2017 enrollment. The four-year-old lottery results will be posted on the preschool website tomorrow. I encourage all waitlisted four-year-old families to be patient as situations change and slots may open. Thank you for your interest in our program, and we wish you all a good night.
Thank you.
years?
That's fine.
All right.
I did it a long time ago. That's why I can never change it.
No, he's in LA, so I don't have no idea what I did.
No, you're done.
Yes, you can't change it.
You guys ready?
Yes, sorry.
Yes. All right. Good evening and welcome to the February 2nd, 2017 regular meeting of the school committee. If you would please all join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, I will take a quick run through our agenda. We have an opportunity for recognitions tonight, our first opportunity for public comment, and then reports to the school committee from student council, our liaison reports, the school committee chair report, the superintendent's report, and then we move on to new business where we have discussion about Nature's Classroom for grade 6, a grade 8 New York overnight travel trip, a stipend approval request, a budget transfer, capital project school department article 17-049, Business Professionals of America Club overnight travel intent, school committee policy IMG animals in school, and then under old business we have one item tonight, which is school committee policy KE school related problems and concerns, up for its third reading. We will then have our second opportunity for public comment and our items by consensus, and then once that concludes we will break into executive session in order to review executive session minutes, and then we will enter back into open session and adjourn. At this time, Dr. McLeod, do we have any recognitions this evening?
Yes. So last week, or last meeting, I recognized Dan Norton for his presentation at the Martin Luther King, yeah. And I received a really nice email from Norman Kumalo, and he was asking that Andrew Longoria be recognized. On December 6th, I reached out to Mr. Longoria for background information on the graduating class of 18 activities and program. The graduating class of 18 applied for an invitational entry to the 2017 Boston Marathon. This was the group's first application ever to the Invitational Entries Program. For that reason, I needed to speak with someone about the group's activities and planned use of the funds raised through the Invitational Entry Program. Mr. Longoria responded promptly to my urgent email, suffice to say, after normal school hours. He was very professional and guided me through the group's planned activities and planned use of the funds. His remarks regarding the group's plan to leave a legacy to the high school and his willingness to link the group's program to a community-wide initiative made the difference in qualifying the graduating class of 2018 submission as a winning application. So, thank you, Mr. Longoria. And that is it for tonight, for me.
Anyone else have any recognitions this evening? All right. So we have our first opportunity for public comment. If there's anyone here from the public to comment, it doesn't appear that there is. So we can move on to reports to the school committee, and I do believe we have student council members.
Yes, we have Bridget Belger and Sarah Durr. Welcome.
Welcome.
So, okay. Mr. Bishop sent out a survey to the whole school, and 600 students replied, and 97 agree that the school is 97%, sorry. agree that the school is physically safe. 95% agree that it is emotionally safe. 95% agree that homework free vacations relieve stress. 89% like the Hiller days where we come in late one Friday every month. 50% want the start times to stay the same.
Oh boy, what a result.
And the administration is going to bring back music on Fridays in between classes, and clubs will get the opportunity to pick the playlist out.
Those are great results.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
And then also, I know we talked last time about PowerSchool, and it is officially up and working, and you can even get the app on your phone. I know I have it. It makes it a lot easier to look at my schedule. And then some events coming up are the Junior Parent College Admission Night is February 16th. The MCAS bio retakes are coming up soon for international students or people who missed it last year. The AMC math test is February 7th, and the robotic team field trip to Worcester is on February 11th, and our next Hiller Day is February 17th.
So can we back up to the app?
Mm-hmm.
So you can get your schedule. Can you get your grades?
Mm-hmm. It's really cool. You can just search PowerSchool in the App Store, and it'll come up, and you use the same login, and it's just like the website.
Yeah.
So you can just log it. And grades, instead of, they used to be open once a month to parents and then twice a month to students, they are now open all the time. Because I know
everyone or to students?
For students, but mm-hmm. parents can obviously log into their students' accounts if mm-hmm. they wish to, mm-hmm. but I know I like that a lot better because sometimes I just miss the week. Like, I don't realize that that's the week that grades come out. So it makes it a lot easier.
Yeah. And, wow, that's great. And how do you feel about the visibility of your grades to your parents?
I think it's good because I think it has, like, its pros and cons because some parents can be a little overbearing on their children with their grades. But overall, like, they have their best interest at heart. So I think it'll work out.
Right.
There'll be more positives than negatives
okay.
in the outcome.
That's great. Thank you.
Of course.
Any other questions or comments? Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming out. Hey, go home and study.
Stay warm.
Stay warm for sure.
Thank you.
All right. We have our opportunity for liaison reports. Did anyone, well, obviously there's a charter committee result to report.
Yes, after 22 meetings and 2 public forums and 2 nights of town meeting, the charter was approved with amendments, so that was great. And so the next step is that it will go to the Attorney General for review, and then it'll be on the ballot in May. But our work is substantially done, and so thank all of you for your contributions and for staying all the way through the conversation at town meeting and voting voting on it. So, yeah, thank you.
Well done. That was a lot of work, I know.
It was a lot of work. Pam Wexlax really did a tremendous job organizing that and circulating it around to all of the committees and informing people. She really did a phenomenal job researching everything.
I thought you guys handled the amendments that came kind of out of the blue very professionally.
Oh, thank you. I mean, it's all part of the process.
Yeah.
And so, you know, at the end of the day, it's our constitution, and so everybody should weigh in on it. And right. So I think it was a good result.
Great. Did anyone else have any other liaison activity?
I guess just from ESBC, if you missed it, the vote for the addition was passed. Mr. Graziano probably would have said that, so thank you everyone who came out to support that. It passed unanimously, so that's great.
Great. I haven't had a CPAC meeting since our last meeting, so I don't have any reports for that. I will say in my liaison role to the press, I did have to speak with them this evening about our naming process and how we felt in our naming process and whether or not it felt like naming a child. Those were some of the questions I was asked. We'll see how that all makes its way to the paper tomorrow, but talked about how we decided to extend the process so that we could get more community input and that we hope to have recommendation by our next meeting.
As of this morning, we had 1,500 responses to the survey.
Whoa.
Wow. Phenomenal.
And I was nervous until I heard that Jean did, in fact, try. I was nervous that people could be weighing in repeatedly and thinking,
right.
Oh, my goodness, but you can't.
I didn't try, but I saw on Facebook that someone tried and was not able. So.
Well, I was going to try, and then I felt like, oh, but what if I get, you know, like, I
what
don't want
to. What if it works?
I didn't want to register
you
my report
twice.
I stopped, too. I got nervous. Okay, so good. That's good. So that was this morning, you know, so
that's
people are
awesome.
Very interested, yes.
Yeah. And the hard copies are at the Senior Center in the library for people who don't have access
to
the computer.
Oh,
yes.
But
will you also pick them up?
Yes, well, I put the deadline on there, so I think they can just be recycled, whatever is left, but I will make sure that happens.
Oh, because I didn't know if they were going to pick one up and then leave it there.
Megan, who's amazing, has the address to return them to on a sticker on every single one. So
she is amazing.
There should be no trouble, but I will check. I will make sure I check them on the 10th.
Alrighty. So we can move on to the chair report, which I was going to get the special town meeting update, but Kelly has already given it, so that's great. So yay, we have four more classrooms. And then I also wanted to let you all know about, I actually hemmed and hawed over having this be in recognitions, but I did get a couple comments from the community on the animal policy, so I'll bring those up to us when we get to that portion of the agenda. But I did receive a really nice message today, and although it is about the school naming and the person actually acknowledged the fact that they were beyond the deadline, I did want to just read the message because it was in recognition of a person in town who was on school committee years ago and had done a lot for the school. So I just think it would be appropriate to at least read it because the person was very kind in their words. So it's from Michael Sullivan, and he writes, "Ms. Nickerson, I was recently made aware of the survey for naming the new school in Hopkinton. I freely admit I have come to the news too late. By way of introduction, my name is Mike Sullivan, Sr. Your address makes me believe you are a neighbor to my son, which I am. We live across the street. When I saw all the proposed individual names for the school, I felt disappointed that I was unaware of the process to submit names. I clearly would have nominated my wife, Anne Marie Hurley Sullivan. I will not try to relate her school committee adventures in detail. However, you need to only consider that after many of her friends encouraged her to seek office, several factors combined to make it the most challenging of times. A limitation on the school budget ran headfirst into statewide school choice. Many of our friends and their children chose to leave. Anne Marie was solicited by some friends to vote with her feet as well. Instead of that choice, her enthusiasm and love for all children promoted our schools. She worked with many talented people in town to bring back the concept to the town that not only is the school system important to the students, it is among the most valuable resources leading to property values and growth. The path back, which Hopkinton has taken, speaks for itself. Trust me, it was not that way. It is difficult, given the successes of the Hopkinton schools, to describe how dark those days were. She was the right person at the right time. I am not writing to ask you to do anything. As I said, I was simply disappointed that I missed the opportunity. However, I feel privileged to share Anne Marie's success with another generation of a school system guardian. May you enjoy continued progress and success. We remain committed to the schools. Our children are Hopkinton graduates. Our grandchildren are in the beginning stages of K-12. Regards, Mike Sullivan, Sr."
That's very nice.
So I haven't had the opportunity to write Mr. Sullivan back yet today. I just received the message today around noon, but I will do so. But I wanted you all just to hear, and I thought it was very kind of him. I've actually met his wife on occasion when she's gotten their grandchildren on the bus, and she's talked to me about her school committee days and wished me luck in mine. So she is a very kind woman, but I appreciate that he reached out to us regardless.
I do think it would be nice if we could go as far back as we can and invite former school committee members to the opening when we open the building.
Yeah, I think that would be a really good idea.
Because, you know, that just is such a reminder. Really, in a short 20 years, the town has done a lot to turn the educational system around dramatically, and that's due to a lot of people whose names we probably couldn't come up with right on the top of our heads. So that would be a really nice gesture.
That's a great idea. So the only other update I wanted to give the committee was that I know in the last meeting I had spoke to you about how the planning board had asked us to comment on the master plan, and I had asked for an extension because the deadline was February 12th and really close to everything we had going on with special town meeting. And what ended up happening was we did semi-sort of get an extension, but what really happened is Mr. Wisemantle offered to come and just speak with us directly at our next meeting on February 16th. So we certainly will add it to the agenda materials, but you already have also the master plan with the implementation portion, and I just remind you it's someone pinpointed the exact page, but it's the last 20 pages where the implementation section is that we should review and look to provide any guidance to Mr. Wisemantle on whether or not we think that the our portion of the implementation is appropriate or if anything's missing or if we have any comments. But he'll be joining.
So that was me that pointed it out, and there's only one thing that pertains to us, one very small portion. So I'll get that to all of you.
Great.
Yep.
So he'll be here visiting with us on the 16th.
Great. Excellent.
And that is all I have for my report today. Dr. McLeod.
So thank you. The school naming survey was distributed yesterday. We met on Monday to come up or get the number of names down to 10. I don't remember how many there were altogether. Do any of you?
40.
There were 40.
Whoa.
Okay.
Got that.
And so we went through them very seriously, really looking at the criteria. John connected us to the policy, reminded us that if we were going to be naming the school after an individual, it had to be after somebody who had had a significant impact on the educational program in our town, and that did help us to eliminate a few of the selections. But we were able to get down to 10 with no difficulty. We were all in agreement with the names that I believe. Mm-hmm. That's the way the discussion felt to me. So the survey has gone out, and I think partially, and thank you for your recommendations on what it should look like. And I think, you know, it's easy to navigate and to see what the biographies are on the individuals, so that it's not just a list of names and people can easily navigate it. But once again, thank you to Megan for working to make it so easy to participate. I mean, she linked it everywhere, plus put it on the, you know, because we were aware of the fact that we wanted people to be able to participate who were not necessarily on the listserv. But because it went out also as a press release, people would know to go. Anyway, as of this morning, we had 1,500 responses. So I'm excited to bring those results to school committee at your first meeting in March. And then as we had agreed on the timeline, you will make a decision and we'll make an announcement at the March 16th school committee meeting as to the name of the new school. So, and I think that will be well within the timeline for ESBC. They were very happy that you were taking it up when you did. So that is the update on the name. I wanted to make a call out for a parent literacy forum. This has been shared on listserv, and I will share it again, taking place next Wednesday, February the 8th at 7 p.m. at the Hopkins School. It will be live on HCAM. Which we wanted to make sure that we were holding it in a place where that could happen, understanding that people may not be able to attend but would be interested. Really in response to some requests that we had received, you had received as a committee, and I had received first through CPAC, but then as a follow-up to really being able to share with the community, you know, what does our literacy program look like, K-5? I'm really excited about this forum because of the people that are participating. We have teachers, we have specialists, we have administrators, and we're going to first do a presentation, and then we're going to have a panel of basically experts, of which we have many in our district, to answer any questions that people may have. So I hope we have a good turnout. Again, I'll send it out on listserv again. The enrollment report has been included in the packet for tonight's meeting, so if people want to take a look at those numbers, they can do so. But you had asked me to come tonight with an enrollment report in response to my request to you about whether or not you wanted me to follow up with an SOI for the Elmwood School. And part of your response was that, you know, after looking at this tonight, that we would also want to take this up with the Board of Selectmen. And so we do have that on an upcoming agenda with them. But what I did is I took a look at the NESDEC projections. And you can see I did the next 4 years, and then I jumped to 24-25 because that was, you should have a document entitled Building Capacity and Enrollment. Okay,
and I just
waiting for give people a minute to check.
It was in the packet?
Yeah.
It was in the packet.
Do you want to scooch over this?
Was it in the second packet?
It was in the second packet.
Yeah. I only printed the first one.
Here, pass those along.
Yeah. Sorry, you can use mine.
You.
Here you go. And then Rob and I will share.
Thank you.
If you wanted a pretty
hopefully that doesn't
So let's,
matter.
If we can begin with Elmwood. What I was interested in thinking about was if we were to submit an SOI, we know that one of the things that they're going to want to know right away is how big does the building need to be. So I was thinking about current projections, and then I took it out as far as 24, 25, because that was the year where the numbers were the highest. What I want to say, however, is that seeing how quickly our numbers have changed and the discussion that we had last night at special town meeting, I am not convinced that these are not going to continue to grow. So this is a minimum, as far as I'm concerned, in terms of what we can expect the needs to be within our buildings. Currently at the Elmwood School, you can see on the far right-hand column that if we look at 24-25, we will need 24 classrooms there. Currently, she's using 23. You can see that class size would remain pretty stable at 22 to 23 students in a classroom. She currently is using all 23 of her 23 classrooms, but has indicated that when the preschool goes to the new building, that will open up 4 classrooms. I would recommend, and we don't need to get into the details tonight, but what I wanted to provide for you is the opportunity for us to start thinking about what the other elementary buildings in the middle, what the other buildings look like in terms of capacity as well. So when we come back to think about an SOI, there are different opportunities of looking at what that might look like. But definitely this is just like bare minimum if we were to go for the same number of classrooms that are currently in the building. Okay.
Can I ask you one question? Mm-hmm. So I see this says she's hoping to return one to the health room. Does that mean right now there's not a separate health room?
That is correct. We the health room teacher gave up her classroom last year when the preschool came in.
So really there at the building, if everything is in the space it should be, there are 26 classrooms available. Is that right?
Available?
I mean, there are 26 classrooms. So if we're using 23 right now and there are 4 being used by the preschool, mm-hmm. minus 1 for the health room.
Oh, thank you.
Is that right? So there would be.
Yeah.
So we can have 26 actual dedicated classrooms without compromising any of the
right.
related
which,
arts.
Which, that's in my what opinion, doesn't give us any room for any wiggle room. So, right, correct.
Okay.
Yep.
Of those classrooms, am I right that some of them are modular classrooms?
Yes, at the end, which are being used by the preschool, they're very much connected to the rest of the school, and they're in high demand. Because they're carpeted and air-conditioned.
Okay.
So when we say modular, sometimes we think we have to go outside to get to them.
Well, I wasn't thinking of that so much as my understanding, and it's been a number of years since we voted them in, was that there is a life expectancy on those that is shorter than the building. And I can't remember how
definitely
long they've been there.
Definitely something
and how
we
long
would need to look at as part of the SOI. Definitely. Yeah. I know when we were talking about the center school and full-day kindergarten 3 years ago, we looked at could we possibly move those classrooms over. So, yeah, good point. Moving on to the Hopkins School, even more concerned there. When you look, again, I'm jumping ahead, but currently they are using 23 sections, and this is just for classrooms, right? So whether it's a co-taught or a gen ed, these are classrooms. This does not count specials rooms. There is a health room in this school. But as you can see, the available classrooms, and she talks about health, science, and literacy and math support. The science room and the literacy and math support room are in the middle section of the building. They're designed as large group rooms, and as part of the design, there's no outdoor windows. So they don't feel like it would be an appropriate classroom setting for a group of kids to be all day, all year.
And they're not doing that right now. They're not using those.
There are no children in there all day. It's not being used as a classroom. She does have access to 23. With not everything is being used right now. Class size, again, 22, 23. We're hovering. When we get to 25, that's when we get nervous. 22-23 in a 4-5 building, those are acceptable numbers. The problem becomes when you start thinking about in-class, so inclusion. And we want to provide as many opportunities for inclusion as we possibly can. In an inclusive classroom environment, you want the numbers to be closer to 20. So once you reduce the numbers in order to provide additional opportunities for inclusion, that raises the numbers in other classrooms. So, you know, a 20 to 22 average is a much better place to be in order to give us that flexibility. You can see, though, that out as far as 24, 25, she will be looking at, you know, almost 600 children in the building. And would need 25 sections. So when we start thinking about Elmwood School, we really need to think about both of those schools and what configuration it might be, how big we need to be recommending the Elmwood School could be, etc. So this is going to obviously warrant a lot of study. And then finally, Mr. Keller, who is here tonight, helped me really think about how do we best explain or really depict what classroom configuration and class size and building capacity could look like at the middle school, because it's very different because of the team model that is used there. And Alan, Mr. Keller, gave just a wonderful interview today on Highlights on the Hill, and we were talking about the importance of the team model at the middle school. It's one of the strengths of the program. And so what we thought was really what we want to talk about is the number of students. And you can see that from 2016-17 to 2024-25, you know, there's going to be almost 900 children in the building. And that's the projection today. Mm-hmm. I'm going to continue to say that I think that's low. If he were at 900 students, he would need 42 classrooms, and class size would be at around 21. He currently, at 38 classrooms, has no available space. And this is only for regular classrooms. This does not count any of the specials classrooms. It doesn't count any of the pull-out services. So there is some room, a little bit of flexibility if he had to, but he feels confident that with looking at scheduling, there are some things that he could do over time that he feels comfortable, and you can ask him yourself when he comes up, with being able to manage the numbers of additional kids because of the numbers of sections that he has to spread them across. So we're not worried about the middle school. There's a separate report from Mr. Bishop about the high school that's also been shared in your report. And I think, you know, when he thinks about semesters and electives and class size, because of the way the schedule works at the high school, there's just built-in more flexibility. One of the things that Mr. Bishop has mentioned over time is, you know, even looking at having students having flex schedules so that not everybody's arriving at school at the same time could help us with capacity. So at the middle school and high school, I feel confident that we can manage the influx of additional enrollment. It's at the Elmwood Hopkins level that I think we need to really dig in deeply and really do a very in-depth study.
So with the preschool leaving the middle school, is that space being utilized?
Right, so I asked that question.
Or is Tucker accepting it?
Yeah, well, and we don't have to continue that relationship going forward. Alan, I feel funny talking about him because he's right there. Why don't you come on up, because you're next anyway. that would be a great question for you to answer, Mr. Keller.
So we had three preschool classrooms previously when the preschool was there, and so one of those classrooms is now being utilized by a math teacher. So we because we have a large eighth grade class this year, it's 800 kids. thankfully, it's 309 students, and so that's the largest we've had in a while. So we wound up adding two teachers. So one of those math teachers is in one of those rooms. And then the space that was commonly referred to in the building as the preschool space, which used to be the cafeteria when it was a middle school, high school. On one of those sides, it's being leased by Tech, and so it's the Educational Collaborative has a therapeutic program in there with, I think, about six students. And we have one student anyway that's from Hopkinton, and other students are from a variety of communities in the Tech Collaborative, in the Educational Collaborative. And then we have, on the other side of that, we just this year got a grant from the Metro West Community Healthcare Foundation, and that's our START program. So we have a transition program. The high school began it last year here at the high school, and this is our first year having the START transition program. So those three spaces are currently being used. But as Dr. McLeod said, you know, there is flexibility.
However, it's not ideal because it's not, there's a divider. I mean, just from a noise perspective. So it feels like the same conversation we had at the new school, which is a one-year, you know, replacement if we had to do it, but it wouldn't be an appropriate permanent solution.
Right. Anyone else have any questions?
Okay, and so my final part of my report tonight has to do with the letter that was sent out this afternoon regarding the lead report that we received, and I wanted to include it in my report because obviously there's much more information to gather. My interest, having just received the information on Tuesday, was to put things in place immediately wherever we possibly could, particularly where there was direct access through drinking fountains, and then to inform people of the information that we had to date. And so I had to act very quickly to do that, and really the summary of the communication that went out today was on immediate remediation. Having said that, the DPW has been, as always, fabulous to work with, and we will continue to work with them on, as well as Mr. Rogers, on what are some more long-term measures that would be realistic to put in place. We know that there's nothing realistic at the center school, and any measures that we have in place there we know need to be in place from now until 2018. But when we read about, or we learn about, how many were there, six drinking fountains at the high school in this relatively new building? You know, some research is warranted on why is that, what is the source, are there some things that we can do around that problem? Conversely, just before I came tonight, the Elmwood results were finally released, and there was only one, no issues in the kitchen, and only one drinking fountain that was affected. Mm-hmm. So there's definitely a lot of question marks around why that might be. The two main remediations that we put in place are consistent with what is happening across the state. The first is flushing. So when they did the flush test, which, as I've explained in the letter, means that they run the tap for 30 seconds, the results following the flush test in most cases were then no longer at a level that we would need action. The fact that there were any results that meant that the flush test was not effective meant that we were going to apply the same level of rigor to all of our sinks. So I shared the communication that went out immediately from Kevin Welch, Director of Food Services, to all of his cafeteria workers. And not only the remediation, but the fact that he's going to be monitoring it through the logs. So they're going to be logging, and the level, 30 seconds is not enough. I said 60 seconds, he said 90. So, you know, I think that I'm feeling really good about that being in place immediately in all of the kitchens, and then all of the drinking fountains where there were any results have been disconnected. At the Hopkins School, that meant that really there was only one working fountain remaining, so we have already ordered. Mr. Dumas said it would be okay and gave us the go-ahead to order additional water for both the Center School and the Elmwood School.
Bubblers.
Yeah. Well, what is it called?
The big 5-gallon Poland Springs.
Poland Springs receptacle things.
So I wanted the school committee to know that these were immediate measures, that clearly a lot more information has to be looked into in terms of what other fixes can reasonably take place. So I wanted to give you an opportunity for questions and remarks at this point.
Well, I guess we have to figure out how are we going to remediate beyond shutting things off. Are there options in terms of filtering? Or obviously replacing all of the pipes is the most expensive and aggressive response and probably not realistic, or at least in the short term. So what can we do in terms of filters? Or, you know, my daughter was the class treasurer of last year's graduating class, and they actually planned to give the Brita stations as their class gift to the water fountains, and it was too expensive, so they didn't have enough money left over. But maybe there's something like that we can do that would just remediate what the issues are. And I didn't know if maybe our school physician would have some information that she could share with parents as far as, you know, what level of exposure causes a concern, or what you would do about it, or when would you call your doctor, or what would you look for, or any kind of information like that. Because my kids fill up their water bottles 4 times a day here, so it's disconcerting for all of us.
Definitely.
And I thank you for getting on top of it, and I thank you for doing the test, because it wasn't required. And so as unsettling as it is to know, it's better to know. For sure.
I did in the letter link some useful, some links where there's a lot of information. And I think one of the things that I didn't look at it in depth, but one of them was, you know, what are some signs of illness?
Okay, I'll go and look at that.
But I will absolutely reach out to our school physician tomorrow. I had indicated in my letter that I would be following up to the Elmwood School. So in doing that, I can add, you know, some information from our school physician, or at least her recommendation.
I had a question just about the test itself. I know we're not required to do that, so it is good that we did it, but has it been done in other years?
Not this extensively, no.
But I guess there were a couple people that asked if a couple of years ago, or however many years ago, were there any tests to be able to say definitively that the lead is a newer problem, or are there kids who have been exposed to it all the way through?
What I can tell you is that the town is required to test periodically. I think it's every 3 years. We have done testing in response to situations, but that has been targeted on certain
particular
problem areas.
Yeah.
So no, we don't have a baseline. What is interesting when you look at the results, and the results will be published on MassDEP's website, and you can see and compare our results to the results of other communities, is that I think it's troubling to people to have any allowable level of lead.
Mm-hmm.
Like, how can that be allowable? And I'm definitely not an expert. I have to assume that it's allowable because it's not considered a health risk.
Right.
So overall, the numbers were not greatly above, right? And then they responded to the flush tests. But wherever there was any, you know, we weren't going to be in a place of flushing a fountain before a child drank from it. So whenever there were any of those kinds of inconsistent results, we just shut them off completely. So it's difficult to know. We are advised, and I did say in the letter as well, that the DPW has assured us that it's not the town's water source. And somehow between the water arriving in the building and getting to its destination, its faucet, it's exposed to lead. So yes, we need to do some more exploring. One other interesting fact is that the classrooms at the center school that were affected were exclusively in the 1954 edition.
Really?
Yes. And that the older part of the school was just fine.
It must be something with building materials that are used at different times.
Yep. They just have to
at different time periods.
Yep.
And here on the EPA's website, it says homes built before 1986 are more likely to have lead pipes, fixtures, and solder.
Uh-oh. Which, except that the high school in Hopkins, you wouldn't have expected to have anything pop.
Yeah. Yeah.
I was wondering if you've been in touch with Compass or anyone from the new school to talk about their thoughts on what they're planning to use for piping. If we, I mean, I know that it's a time crunch, right? They're starting to put the foundation and build, but they obviously have ideas for materials. I don't know how those compare to materials that were used at the high school.
I don't know that you can even get it anymore, though. Like, I don't.
No, but the high school wasn't built before 1986, so whatever they used here,
I will find
might
out.
Still be something.
No, I have
that
not reached out to them yet. But given this report, people are going to want to know.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Well, it also may be in just the connectors that are to the town water, but we don't know that either. So,
right, hard to find the source, but.
I mean, with all of the interest around this in the state, there have to be some experts, I got to
think. Yeah, exactly.
That can advise us.
Right. So,
but the town has, sorry.
No, go right ahead.
The town, again, John Westerling and Eric Cardi reached out to me again today to say, you know, if there's anything that we can do. You know, I look to them as well for their expertise. So they're working with Al and myself and Ralph to continue to see what we can do.
Thank you.
So I don't know for sure if the kitchen sinks and things are being used with the after-school programs in Hopkins and Elmwood, but it may be worth asking, because if they're not using the same flushing techniques as the kitchen staff is, then they would have the same issue.
I am told that it only has to be done once a day after it's been sitting all night. However, it wouldn't hurt if they were going to be doing some kind of activity to just flush it again, right? So after school program use, I will look into that too. Thank you. And sorry to end my report on such a note. I should have started with that somehow.
I wanted to just circle back to in your report about, when we were talking about the enrollment and that we were, and it was in relation to our questions about filing the SOI.
Yes.
Do we have follow-up conversations scheduled in one of our future agendas to talk about the SOI again so that we're making a decision before the deadline, or?
So the deadline is the end of April, and clearly I have a draft that I can be working from. I think the important thing is for us to really have a deep discussion about what the configuration might look like and the numbers of classrooms. I thought that the school committee wanted also to have the Board of Selectmen weigh in, so I don't know what order you want to do it in, whether or not we should bring this back to our next meeting for further discussion so that we have a better idea of what we're wanting to submit before we go to the Board of Selectmen, or...
Well, I more just was trying to figure out our scheduling. So,
yeah.
Are we? Well, I guess that's a point of discussion that we could have right now. Is what do we want to have our plan together before we go to the Board of Selectmen? That would make the most sense to me. Other than
That seems like the right way, since they don't really, their purview is not really what the right configuration of classrooms is.
And what was our reasoning for including them in this part?
Well, they have to sign it.
Yeah.
That's a good point.
What I would suggest then is that I follow up with Lauren and Vanessa, and that we come back to the next meeting with a report and some options.
Okay.
We've done some thinking. We've done some brainstorming. What that might look like with room built into the plan for some flexibility. I think that's really going to be important that we have. And we heard it at the planning, at the special town meeting from people that were there. Just make sure that whatever you're building that's going to be big enough to take into consideration our ongoing enrollment, which we don't see any end in sight. So I heard someone say at some point they're going to stop moving in, and I thought, well, there are always going to be young families replacing.
Yeah.
There always are going to be our young, you know.
Right, even when the town is,
absolutely.
When there is no more buildable land.
Even when there's
land,
no more building.
People retire and move away,
that's
and
exactly
families
right.
move
so
in.
I do think we have an exciting opportunity to think outside the box. And I would really appreciate
the opportunity to think about coming to your next meeting with some things for us to kind of explore. And I could do that with Lauren and Vanessa.
Mm-hmm. I think that makes sense. I think.
I think the town meeting people that are saying that, though, are thinking strictly about building versus the whole turnover of older generations versus younger. Because I think the interesting thing that was brought up when the NASDAQ gentleman was here as well is that people don't think about, like, condo sales and all of those things. They don't register those into the additional student population.
Right. So. Yeah, a lot of people think building over 55s is a good way to go, and it doesn't, you know, probably makes some difference, but so many people just move in town that it still opens right. up a new a home for a young family, yeah. and yeah. that's typically what we see.
But we do know from Don Kennedy's report that the growth is not, I was feeling like some people were thinking the growth is really happening K-1, and then those K-1 kiddos will move through the system, and that's not true. The growth is coming in mostly at the elementary level, and then they're staying, for sure. But there's growth projections across, we know, 308 across K-12, pre-K, mm-hmm. no, K-12, in the next 10 years. And I think if they're calling out 308, then we got to be prepared for 500.
Well, just, I mean, thinking logically, so in the last 20 years, education has really turned around in this town, and we're one of the best districts in the state, if not the country. We don't have plans to go backwards from that, right? So people, we know that people move here because of the school system, so there's no logical reason to think that that's going to slacken in any way. And so whether they're moving to an apartment or people are retiring and they're filling that home or whatever, I think you're absolutely right. There's absolutely no reason to believe that enrollment is going to go back in the other direction unless everyone stops having children.
And I met, yeah, to your point, I met with a parent, a kindergarten parent who will be moving into the town in the summer. And we've talked about this before, but she said, you know, we really did our research. She said, and, not but, and so we know it's a wonderful district. And she works in Rhode Island and her husband works in Marlboro, and it was perfect landing place by 495. So we know not only the reputation of the schools, but the convenience of the location and all the beautiful resources available to the town. It's just, it's all of the natural resources are really lovely. And so I think it has it all.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it sounds like she was convinced to move in town without having a residency requirement.
I told you, I had a place all picked up.
So. I have to just add as an anecdote, on the way out of special town meeting on Tuesday night, I joked with Chief Lee about the potential that he might have needed to move to town should things have moved forward. And he said, yeah, Norman and I already picked out a place together. We're going to be like bosom buddies. And I was dying. It was the best line of the night. So now that we've wrapped up reports, we can move on to new business, which I'm sure Mr. Keller is like, yes, could you please move on to nature's classroom for me, please?
I'm enjoying that.
You know, but can I just, before he starts, so when I arrived at the HCAM this afternoon, and it was Alan's turn for his, what are we calling it? The
highlights.
No, but the school, the moment in...
Oh, a day in the life.
Day in the life, thank you. Moment in time. I walked in and he started talking about his tie. And he said, you know, I'm from Pennsylvania and Groundhog Day is a really big deal. So, you know, we were teasing him today and when he walked in. But what were Phil's recommendations today?
So 6 more weeks of winter. Okay. He saw a shadow and it's 6 more weeks of winter.
All right.
Yes.
Lying room.
Yes, I mean, I'm a Western Pennsylvania, so I'm a Steelers fan, so last weekend was hard for me, so I feel like I had to bring back some Western Pennsylvania pride today, so hence the tie. But I had a backup that I was going to use for this afternoon, or not a backup, but my tie B, and then for tonight, and I left it at home, so
so we get the groundhog,
yes.
Which is awesome.
All right, so Mr. Keller, do we need... an introduction on Nature's Classroom, a little bit? I don't know.
We've talked about
this many times before. But
yes, yes. Actually, so next year, so we're proposing it for 2017, October 24th, Tuesday, October 24th through Friday, October 27th. It's our grade 6 field trip to Nature's Classroom. If approved, it would be our 25th year that the middle school would attend Nature's Classroom. And our third year going to the Charlton site. So we switched a couple years ago. We used to go to Colebrook, Connecticut, and this is now at Charlton, Mass. So it is for all of our grade 6 students, and we would travel by school bus.
Great. Any questions, anybody? I know you guys have had kids go through it, so you know any questions.
Well, you haven't had somebody go through it yet.
I have not.
Ah. Both of mine went through it, so I have a few
more years before that happens. Although
it's a great program.
Based on the Facebook post you see that day, it seems like it's traumatic, but I'm like, go ahead, take them.
I have one question.
Sure,
I just thought of. So I know one of the things we talked about was the hope that there would be more faculty participating,
yes,
given that you were closer. What did you find?
The faculty participation has gone up significantly. So, yeah, our last year at Colebrook, we actually had to employ Nature's Classroom staff to sleep in some of the, to sleep along with a parent in some of the, suddenly I can't think of what they're called.
Cabins.
Yeah, thank you, cabins, yeah. Yeah, and Colebrook is more like cabins, whereas Charlton is more like dorms. And so last year we did not have to employ any Nature's Classroom staff. It was all parents and teachers, but we had a lot more teachers. And you know, we have teachers that can commit to 2 days or can commit to one overnight. And Mrs. Ben Bennick does all the logistics for that, so it's actually worked out quite well.
Awesome,
great. All right, well, if we have no questions, then at this time I would seek a motion to approve the Grade 6 Nature's Classroom Overnight Intent to Travel request taking place from October 24th through October 27th, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Cavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, and it's unanimous and so carries. Thank you.
Thank you.
And I know we have next our Grade 8 New York Overnight Travel Intent to Travel.
Right, so as you may recall, this year, that the 2016-2017 school year, is the first year that we'll be changing from Washington, D.C. to New York City. So obviously, in order to meet the deadline of getting in our request, I submitted this. We don't know yet if New York City will be a successful Grade 8 field trip. I'm obviously optimistic about it. But this field trip request is for next school year, obviously, from Wednesday, June 6th, 2018, to Friday, June 8th, 2018. And I need to apologize because I was working with a travel company to get an estimated cost for next year, and you'll notice that I never actually went back and put the figure in there. So this year's field trip is $709. The estimated cost for next year from the travel company is $715 per person. So I apologize for that not making it into this document. Again, that would be, well, this would be traveling by charter bus as opposed to school buses that we do for Nature's Classroom.
How's your participation rate for this year, Alan?
From students?
Yes.
Right now I believe we have 272 students who have signed up for the trip. Every student who's not going, I've communicated with the family, and there's been a variety of reasons from, you know, my child doesn't do overnight trips, don't you remember when he didn't go to Nature's Classroom, to, you know, there's been a few, I would say probably about five or six have said, we've done New York City as a family, and so we're not interested in paying that kind of money for it. So it's similar to what I expected. It's, I think right now we're right around 30 students, just over 30, who are not attending.
Yep.
That's more than usual, but this grade is 40 students more than is typical. So I have to figure out the percentage compared to previous years, but it's... that's kind of where we're at right now.
Well, this is an example, and I said it today in the interview, of one of the things that you've done to improve, the quality of the experiences at the middle school. And I just want to thank you for taking it on, because I know that you wanted to make the trip educational in nature and not just social. And I think that with any change that it meets with resistance. So this year is the first year, and the fact that there are only 30 not participating, I think, is, again, due to your leadership and the way in which you engage people and provide the information. I would hazard a guess that families have also done Washington as a family. So I'm excited to hear how it goes. I'm also excited about the opportunities that I've read. The kids are going to be able to have a really a truly educational experience. So thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone have any questions?
Well, I like to ask my question every year regarding the dance.
But I would be disappointed if you would not.
But we're not having a dance.
Correct, yes.
So I have nothing else to say.
Well, at least you mentioned it. That's what I was hoping for.
I thought you would like it. You had your tie and everything. You were ready. So thanks for taking
it. I think it's probably due to you, though, Jean, that there's no dance.
Eventually, yes, please let all of the girls know that it was for Mrs.
Birchman.
You
know what? They're going to start playing Footloose on your front.
I think it sounds really awesome. I'm excited to see how it goes.
Thank you.
Just made my second payment today, so.
Yes.
It's due tomorrow.
Yeah.
For those watching.
It's your son, right?
Is my daughter.
Is she excited?
She's very excited. She was very, you know, because our class never gets anything because we're so big and, you know, everything gets canceled. But she was very excited that there was rumors of
it
different
going
locations,
away. Yes.
So when it finally was
announced.
I imagine
we might just travel to Worcester overnight, but not go over big.
Would that have included a dance?
See? For a dance. No.
All right. Well, since there's no more questions, I would seek a motion to approve the Grade 8 New York overnight intent to travel request taking place from June 6th through June 8th, 2018.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Kavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
And it's unanimous and so carries. All right. And we have a stipend approval request from Mr. Keller as well.
Yeah, so we unfortunately weren't able to field a math counts advisor for the school year. And so that stipend has gone unutilized. And this year, one of the teachers, actually started it last year, one of the teachers, Kathy Anasaskis, had come to me with an idea of starting a peer tutor club in which she works with eighth grade students and develops some teaching skills with them. And then they wound up during what we call Hiller Block. She winds up matching students, those eighth grade quote-unquote tutors or quote-unquote teachers that she's trained to be tutors, with students who are recommended for needing some additional skill remediation. So that's actually gone really well, and that happens after school. It happens sometimes during Hiller Blocks when students are available. So I would be interested in moving that forward as a club.
Anyone have any questions?
Mm-hmm. I think it's nice for both the students participating as tutors and also for the students receiving.
Yeah, it's been a real win-win.
All right, great. Then at this time, I would seek a motion to approve the stipend request allocation as outlined in the agenda materials.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Kavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
And it's unanimous and so carries. I don't know. Do we have anything else for you, Mr. Keller, tonight?
I believe so.
All right.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Nice to see you. Good night.
Have a good night.
All right, our next item on the agenda is budget transfers with Mr. Dumas.
Okay, there are six budget transfer requests. If you've been paying close attention, there were two threes, so I just renumbered them. So I think we ought to take these one at a time if that's...
happens to me all the time in my drafting. So,
would you like us to do that one at a time, and you can vote on them individually, or would you like to do them en masse?
Anyone have
en masse,
a strong feeling on it either way?
En masse, okay.
All right.
So the first one is to provide funding for the NASDAQ executive search, which is going to cost $6,190 and was not budgeted. The place that there's money available in the budget is the SPED transportation account, and that's because we made a prepayment of our accept transportation last year. So that's 6,190. The second one is one that brought to your attention in my quarterly reports, having to do with tuition reimbursement for teachers. This year it exceeded the amount budgeted by $34,103. The request is to once again take that money from SPED transportation. Item number three is basically a reshuffling of the deck in our tuition accounts. You know that we have two more kids going to Norfolk Aggie than the budget, so that is going to cost us $49,573 more than budgeted. And part of that is that one of the students has a SPED supplement to their education, and that's come in at $4,160 more than we budgeted. SPED collaboratives, we need $30,283, and fortunately in the SPED private tuition account we have money available to offset those. So that would be a reduction in the SPED private budget by $84,000. A lot of that has to do with students who may have been planned to be in a private placement and who ended up in a collaborative placement, which is typically less expensive. Item number four is also related to special education. It's miscellaneous contracted services. That covers a gamut of things. Mostly this year what we're seeing is higher than anticipated costs for students who are visually impaired, whose situations have I guess have been downgraded, and so that they required additional support. And the total of that is $45,874. And once again, that's going to come from SPED transportation. The next two are related to personnel. The first one is transferring funds to the salary reserve from payroll accounts which are under their respected budgets, mostly due to unpaid leaves, where people are going out and being replaced by long-term subs. And naturally, the long-term subs are making less per day than the teachers who are out. In some cases, that would be related to a teacher who's relatively new to the system and falls under the new sick leave rules that have been in place in the contract for probably the last 4 or 5 years. Long-term people fall under an older version of sick leave, which is much more robust and costly to us if they're out on extended leaves. So as a result of those, we actually are going to be able to put almost $41,000 into the salary reserve. Then on the other hand, we have the final transfer request, and those are to transfer funds from the salary reserve to the payroll accounts, which are under their budgets, over their budgets, due to personnel additions and substitute needs. At the center in Elmwood, that's being driven by the fact that the literacy coach was originally going to be funded by the grant, and the grant was taken away. And so we now have to fund that, or we're going to fund that. We are funding it from the operating budget. Elmwood Guidance, I believe that's a long-term sub. SPED Hopkins Teachers, I wish I had all my notes with me. I think we approved the hiring of a teacher, SPED teacher, at the last meeting, perhaps.
Yes, that's right.
At SPED. Middle school classroom teachers, that's an increase that was driven by the addition of a 0.6 middle school SPED teacher that was approved by the committee. SPED high school para, the last meeting you approved a SPED high school para hire. And all of that nets to an additional cost of almost $140,000. So now the important numbers to look at is in the final transfer request, the last line, the salary reserve. If you look at the requested budget of $31,000, that's the $30,694, that's how much we have remaining in the salary reserve right now. And if we jump up to the one with the miscellaneous contracted services, which is one of the number threes, is showing that we have a budget request of $329,000. So that's still a positive variance in that account. So we still have overall a good amount of money consistent with the financial report that I gave you, I think, last month. So we're still in a good place.
So the existing number four, so the bottom of page one,
yep,
adds to the salary reserve by $4,874.
Yep.
Is that, so can we add that to the $3,694? So no. We're really up at...
No, that's embedded in the final budget transfer. See where it says previous transfers, $55,000?
Yes.
In the last item.
Yep.
See that?
That's in there.
That includes that $40,000.
Okay, so this has already been carried to this before,
yep,
you did that, Matt.
Yeah, I have to assume that you're going to approve them
that
as
one.
They go.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
Okay.
Risky. Bummer.
Happy to answer any questions if anybody has any.
I have a related question, and it's not in this budget transfer. Do we already do the budget transfer for the traffic calming, or are we? Is that upcoming?
Kathy and I talked about that. Originally, I had this on this list, and she pointed out to me that she thought that was coming from the gift account, which is fine.
Mm-hmm. From the BAA one?
Mm-hmm. Yep. Okay. So that won't
be a transfer.
So it won't be a transfer. Okay.
We won't need a transfer for that. Yeah.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Thanks.
All right. At this time, I would seek a motion to approve the budget transfers as outlined in the agenda materials.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Cavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Thank you. Unanimous and so carried. Thank you, Mr. Dumas.
Mr. Dumas.
Yeah, you have the next one.
The next one's
capital project.
So we have one capital project warrant tonight. It's number 17049 for $116,123.30. Two invoices. One for BCM for $665.80 related to the system-wide security upgrades. Then the other is from Enterprise Equipment Company, and that's $115,457.50, and that's related to the Hopkins School Boiler Project. We recommend that these items be approved for payment by the school committee.
Did anyone have any questions? All right, at this time I would seek a motion to approve the payment of warrant article number 17-049 in the amount of $116,123.30 to the vendors as outlined in the agenda materials.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Cavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes, and it's unanimous and so carries.
Thank you.
All right, our next item on the agenda is letter F, Business Professionals of America Club, overnight travel, intent to travel. Dr. McLeod.
Thank you. So this is a overnight travel to Framingham Sheraton for the BPA States. My question to Doug Scott, the organizer, as always, when there's overnight travel on a weekend, I'm always concerned about transportation. And he has indicated in the materials that students of legal age will drive their keys will be held by a teacher upon arrival. So once they get to their destination, they won't be on the road again until they leave to go home.
Great.
Other students will be dropped off and picked up by parents. So with those stipulations in place, I recommend that this trip be approved.
Did anyone have any questions?
It is an initial intent. And as I'm looking at it, it's coming up in March. So, you know, I think sometimes I'm still finding that we're not always using the right forms. Typically, you would only get an intent for an out-of-state type of trip. So this is probably not an intent. This is probably going to be the approval for the trip. Although I did say intent. I would suggest that the motion reflect an overnight travel request as opposed to intent.
Okay. Does anyone have any concerns?
Are they, it's not a concern, just a question, are they coming back to school on Monday, or they're not in school on Monday?
Oh, I don't know, Jean, that's good. I see that they're returning on the Monday. So they're gone two nights, leadership, workshop, competed individual and team. My assumption is that if they're not coming back until Monday, that the competition continues on Monday.
Okay.
It says they're picked up on 12:30 on Monday.
Okay.
Okay.
March 7th.
In Boss.
According to the schedule?
Yeah, that's what I thought on the itinerary, so they couldn't really get
it. I don't think they're going to school on Monday.
Well, and parents have to agree to that, right? So. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think the dates might be wrong on the form then, because it says Monday, March 7th.
The 6th on the form.
And this says the 6th.
The 4th to the 6th is the Saturday to the Monday.
What form? 7th would be a Tuesday then.
This thing says the
7th. Intent to travel form says the 4th through the 6th.
I can't read the small print.
Yeah, but okay, well here, let's see if I have it in here.
Saturday must...
You do.
Yeah. Something's wrong somewhere, because
yeah,
the
even their form says the 4th to the 6th, but then their agenda says the 7th.
Where are you looking for
that? It says Friday, March 3rd, Saturday, March 4th.
It's the 4th, 5th, and 6th. I think they just have a typo on their...
They just have a typo on their schedule. It says the 7th.
It says the 7th.
Is the...
The intent is correct.
Okay,
right. Does anyone have any issue with us making this an approval of travel and not...
I mean, I can bring it back, but I just simply think they used the wrong form.
It's not an intent to travel. What do we call it normally?
You just leave out the word intent. So move to approve the BPA overnight travel request.
Right. Okay. All right. I would seek a motion to approve the BPA overnight travel request taking place from March 4th through March 6th, 2017.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Cavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes. Yes, and it's unanimous, and so carries. We now have school committee policy IMG, animals in the school. Dr. McLeod, which I, after you give your initial, I have some feedback on that.
Okay, so I'm actually going to turn this over to Nancy, if I may,
sure,
because
sure.
I know that you've done all the preliminary work on it, to bring it to where we are at this point.
So I started with the MASC version of the animals in school policy, and I then compared it to several policies that were very similar to that. I only included in the packet the Newton one because I liked it. It was basically the same as MASC, but the language was better, grammatically. I included another one to show that there was a range throughout the state, and I can't think of Weymouth. I think. Yes.
Tiny.
That there are policies that are much less specific. I liked the how specific the MASC one was, but I did pull out, because it doesn't match with what we're actually doing, there's a section about fur-bearing animals not being allowed in school. And in fact, I know in several of our schools, they do have classroom pets.
Yeah.
What the policy references is a Department of Public Health policy and what their recommendation is, so I substituted what MASC said for what the Department of Public Health said, which was that classroom pets that are going either both when they're in the school and when they're being fostered at home by families should be kept from coming into contact with wild animals where they could in fact contract rabies, so that should be made clear to families that are fostering and teachers that are having pets. I do think that there is value in pets being in the classroom, and my impression was that was not our intent to change what we're actually doing, but to put a policy in place to reflect it.
Yep, correct.
Good job.
So we did receive two comments. One of them was in your agenda materials. The email that I had received from Peter LeGoy. And then I also received an additional comment yesterday. Regarding the new animal policy from Valerie, and I'm going to totally mess up this name,
Lachansky,
chemistry teacher in the high school.
who just said, hi, Lori, under the poisonous animals, we could we add a clarification that poisonous spiders are not allowed? We sometimes use orb weavers or other non-venomous spiders in science fair projects to study their webs. So.
That was nice.
Yeah. I think both comments are good to add into. I was not aware of the bat houses. My only thing on the bat houses was it came from MASC.
Where in the policy, Nancy, are we referencing bat house? Oh, here, so I see it.
It's
Yeah, so I think the concern also with the like the way poisonous animals is written.
Mm-hmm. So just put the word poisonous before spiders
instead
of
venomous.
I think what we should put is venomous animals instead of poisonous. You know, maybe that would. Because what she's talking about are venomous spiders and non-venomous spiders.
So why not just say venomous spiders, comma, venomous insects, and poisonous snakes?
Yeah,
so
I mean...
So they do use venomous ones or they don't
no,
use
venomous? They use non-venomous spiders.
All right, so just inserting venomous would...
Yeah.
I think I also think that's the intent of the policy is venomous. I don't even think MASC was trying to get rid of all spiders.
Could we just say venomous spiders and insects and get rid of the
yes,
venomous
that's
word
less
twice?
Wordy.
Yes. So we're saying we're going to take out the bat house section?
Take out the...
Where it says bats?
I didn't see that.
Yeah, I mean, we haven't had... The other thing I did look into was to look at what incidents there had been rabies from either fur-bearing or bats or anything in the schools. I was not able to find any connection in Massachusetts to any of these things.
Okay. It does seem that bats is already called out under wild animals, so we could probably just take out that whole section on bats.
Yeah.
Because then we don't have to talk about the bat houses.
Well, right, and it's enough, I think, to say that they're not coming in the school.
Correct.
Right. Yeah. I mean, if what we have had is triple E down there, so if
so
anything, getting
have...
rid of the mosquitoes is a good thing.
So if we take out this whole section on bats... And leave, because of the high incidence of rabies in bats, raccoons, skunks, foxes, it
just
calls it out
inside.
Right there.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
The other thing that I did not pull into the policy was there was at least one policy that they put an exclusion on poisonous animals that they were allowed to be brought in by certified handlers, as licensed handlers.
Let's not go there.
Yeah.
So does the PTA still do the...
The exotic animals guy is what I was thinking.
But he's not venomous, the snake. I didn't mean the guy. I heard the laugh. The snakes that he brings
that
in have been
thinking.
All declawed and taken care of.
Okay.
Devenomed.
Yeah.
That's probably better.
The other question I had, and I don't know if we have any students who have need of a service dog, but we definitely have students who have allergies. How do we handle that? I don't know if we can go to the extreme of saying that it has to be a non-hair dog.
Yeah.
Because certainly they're traveling the entire school as opposed to contained in a classroom. Or how do the other districts?
Yeah.
Or how do we do that?
So, I would suggest that we do it the same way we manage allergies in classrooms, and so we have. You know, nut-free classrooms, for example. And I would suggest that we take it by request. So if there's a need for a student to have a service animal, or if there's a request for a, I don't think they call them service animals, the animals that come in to de-stress.
Therapy dogs.
That we take it by request, we would be aware of any severe allergies within our buildings. And if there were children who had severe allergies within the building, then we would have to deny the request.
Okay.
Or look at the parameters by working with the family. Maybe the animal could come into the school, but not into that child's classroom. So I think we would have to look at each individual situation and consider the request as guided by policy.
Okay.
If that
works. Yeah, so just as long as we have it written that way, or maybe including a, you know, consultation with the nurse, the school nurse must keep all those records.
Well, under student health, we talk about the animals that may cause an allergic reaction impair the health of students. But we don't actually have a section in here about therapy dogs.
Under service animal?
Yeah, it says service animal, so maybe they're using that as a generic term.
Well, I know, but are we distinguishing between...
It's saying guide or assistance specifically. We could change that wording, like, though, to include therapy dogs.
Yeah.
It's like during the finals week, they bring in the therapy dogs and for de-stressing.
Right. Like the puppy bowl.
But also, I mean, it's, you know, therapy pets are different than bringing animals in as a classroom pet, but I would think that it could be still fall under it's at the discretion of the principal.
I'm just not sure, based on what the description of service animals are, that we would want to put therapy under there.
But I don't think what I'm saying is I don't think we have to put it under that at all. I think that can
It fits under educational program.
Yeah. Oh, you're saying like it falls under that, so it's not excluded. Got it.
Right.
Oh, here we go.
But use you could also, but just put use of animals therapy. We could just add something explicit so that it's demonstrated that we've
including classroom pets or therapy.
Yep.
Animals. Yeah. Okay.
I'll make those changes. Something that caught my eye. The last paragraph on page 2. If, in the opinion of the school principal or authorized designee, any service animal is not under the control of its handler, or if it is not housebroken. And the reason it caught my eye is that we know service animals are just so highly trained.
Right.
That they wouldn't pass the test to become a service animal.
Yeah.
They wouldn't. It could be that they're not under the control of the handler, and that would be the fault of the handler and not the animal. But it's not a big deal, but I think it goes without saying that I don't know that it has to be called out by policy. It just caught my eye. That's all.
The other thing that I'm just now thinking about is during in the wellness fair, sometimes they bring animals in. Remember there was kangaroo, the baby kangaroo?
Yeah.
A couple years ago. I just want to make sure that that's all.
I think that also would be educational.
Yeah, I think it would be in regards to...
But it's outside of the school day. So is it still covered? You know, so it's essentially, it's that in particular isn't necessarily a rental, but we do have other, you know, programs that rent space. I just want to make sure this is also, that they'll have this and know.
I think, Jean, what we might want to do, just like we did most recently with another policy, with the waiver, is cross-reference the buildings and grounds application process in this policy, because they have to have insurance, they have to go through. So even if it's an HPTA-organized event, they would need to secure insurance, and it should reference our animals in school policy going forward. Yeah. Would that?
Yeah, I think that would be good.
I'd do it.
Yep.
You know, the second sentence of the educational program where we're going to put in or therapy animals, maybe we should change curriculum objectives to something more generic, like educational objectives or something, because the therapy dog wouldn't be curriculum-based.
That's true.
Right.
They are educationally-based.
Yes. Well, you could just put including but not limited to achieving specific curriculum objectives. And it's still left up to the building principal.
Okay. But use of animals, including but not limited to, did you say? Or including classroom pets or therapy dogs to achieve
specific curriculum objectives. I got to read.
I think educational is broader, though.
I think it is, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's fine.
So what's fine? We're going to take out specific curriculum objectives?
Just take out curriculum and put educational.
I think that's a good call.
Do we have a guidelines for animals in school or on that?
Nope, we do not.
So that's kind of an odd reference.
Okay. So maybe allowed by the building principal, provided student health and safety is not jeopardized and the individual requesting that the animal be brought to school is responsible.
You could just say adhering to any conditions established by the principal.
Adhering to any conditions established.
So, I'm sorry, the guidelines for animals in schools or on school grounds is, I believe it's a DPH policy.
It's not something we have to write? No. Well, in that case, then it should be in the cross-reference.
It should be in the cross-reference.
Yeah.
Nancy, can you say that again? What should be in the cross-reference?
Where it says it under education program, guidelines for animals in schools or on school grounds is a DPH, Department of Public Health. I can send you the link for that.
Okay.
So should we just put in front of it to the Department of Public Health's guidelines for so that it just states what it is? Because it makes it sound like it's ours.
Yeah.
It does. Yes.
Well, it's right up above. Does it need to be in the educational program at all? Because it's that first.
Oh, I missed that. You're right. It's already defined.
Yes, it does.
Oh. Oh, then health has to be capitalized.
Thank you, Kelly, for reading backwards.
Yes, Jean made a good point that health needs to be capitalized.
Oh, my.
Yeah.
Okay. So we leave that the way it was because it's in quotations. It's referring back to the previous paragraph.
Yeah.
And then we cross-reference the document under cross-reference. Mm-hmm. Okay. Want me to bring this back as it is for next time? Just clean it up and. Did we want to take anything out? It seems to be an awful lot under service animals. I feel like we could probably take some of that out.
Well, I mean, because I pulled it from another policy, I included it as it was, but I think people know what service animals are. I don't think it needs to be defined.
No. So we do not permit discrimination. That's a good paragraph. But then the second paragraph is what you're suggesting we don't need, Nancy?
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, right.
Well, except that the second paragraph, I think most people typically think of a dog, and this is specifically saying you can have a miniature horse.
Wow.
I actually used to own miniature horses. Mine were not therapy.
I'm just trying to imagine.
Nor were they that small,
Jean. That's all.
They do not go to the bathroom inside. It's remarkable. Okay. I don't. Mine missed that memo.
Don't they take up the size of a Great Dane?
No, like, no. Oh, they're tiny.
Oh, really miniature?
Really tiny.
The size of a what?
Smaller than a Great Dane.
Okay.
Like a. I mean, some of them are.
Okay.
I don't know that we would. You know. Have one ever,
right, but it's not
if
for
we
us.
Don't if we don't want to.
Hey, I don't know. Like I guess I like the specificity that's in here with it, but
there's a liability piece down there too.
Yeah.
Is it harmful to have all this language or? Just
in the first sentence at the top of the third page, it says the parent or guardian of the student having custody and control of the dog. It should really say the animal because we've used animal everywhere else.
And the horse wouldn't appreciate being called a dog.
They're very sensitive about that.
I mean, the only thing in here is that we probably don't have is that when a student, the second to last paragraph says, will be accompanied by a service animal at school or in other district facilities on a regular basis, such staff member or student's parent or guardian, as well as the animal's owner and any other person who have custody and control of the animal, will be required to sign a document stating that they have read and understood the foregoing. If that, So it makes me wonder, I mean, like, is that to notify people of the policy?
I guess, yeah. Jean, I am really asking this question in all seriousness. In the last paragraph, would we ever think of a horse on a bus?
I know, I was just reading that. I guess I think we should say animal.
I think so too. Yeah,
if they can go upstairs, they can go upstairs. I really, really can't imagine that.
Can horses go upstairs?
Upstairs?
Yeah. Well, I mean, they might.
We would have to have a ramp, Nancy.
And I can't imagine. They're so tiny. I don't know how they would get their little hooves, or their little legs all
cute?
The way.
They must be very cute.
They're adorable. They're like pocket-sized ponies.
Let's do it.
Now you guys are going to have to all go home and Google, because it is a real thing.
Do it right now.
Because is this
meeting
related?
I wish we still had them. We could have a field trip.
It is. Yes. We could put it up on the screen.
I'm going to need to do this.
We're going to have to install an elevator for a miniature horse.
Oh, gosh.
Okay. So we'll leave it as it is. We'll change dog to animal. Is it cute?
And there's dog to animal in the last sentence, too.
They have little vests.
Well, I would think they would need that.
And sneakers.
Is he adorable?
It has sneakers. Well, they must be smart if they're able to
they're
be smart.
They're tremendously
animals.
Smart. Sneakers. Yes, right. Because they're nice and clean.
Oh, to stay clean?
Better than becoming horseshoes.
Oh, my gosh.
But just think
that is awesome.
Watching.
This one's even smaller. This one really does look like a dog.
So now on school committee coffee talk.
That one looks like
horses.
A dog. That one really does look like a dog.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, they are, yeah.
Jean, I take
really
it back.
Small.
I think I
we're
take all it back. That does look like a dog.
Yeah. Yes. I could go on the bus.
All right.
Yeah, I think the changes we've done so far are great, and maybe we can, on second reading, consider whether or not we want to cut down the service animal part, but I don't think any of it's harmful, so.
Yeah. The only thing, and I'm just, and we, yes, I think we should do that. The person, it says, it talks about the allergic reaction and talks about the person having custody and control of the animal will be required to remove the animal to a different location designated by the building principal or designee, and an alternative plan will be developed with appropriate district staff. Could include the reassignment of the person having custody and control to a different classroom assignment. Okay, I see what it's saying. It still gives, I just want to make sure that it gives control to the principal to make accommodations, reasonable accommodations within a classroom assignment. Assuming that, let's say, you know, this student arrives mid-year, is placed in a classroom where there's already a child that has an allergic reaction. So. And it does. It's designated by the building principal. So, okay. I'll clean this up and bring it back as best I can.
All right. And we have one item under old business, which is school committee policy KE, which is back for our third reading. And
it did make everything red.
It was perfect.
I kind of like the multiple colors.
We didn't want to do any more color coding. Given that this
is the colors. I usually have the colors. I used the wrong printer.
So this should reflect all of our changes that we've discussed. It shows the things that have been taken out, the things that have been reordered. You had asked the last time, or maybe that was the time before, that the assistant superintendent have a blurb. So that was there. I believe that things are lined up so that they go in sequential order. And that the things that are called out at the level prior are moved forward using the same language. I think it's a useful document.
We have no need of an ombudsman.
No.
No need of any what?
Ombudsman. I think Kathy missed that part.
No, I did not.
It lays it out very clearly who you contact you. With what question that you may have.
Somebody shared it with me.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. Then if there are no further comments or additions or changes needed, this time I would seek a motion to approve policy KE
as amended and included in our agenda materials.
So moved.
Second. You guys are doing such a good job.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Kavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
And it's unanimous and so carries. We have no one here from the public for public comment, so we are moving right on to items by consensus. Dr. McLeod.
Yes,
I will.
There's a lot of items by consensus tonight, so I want to make sure that everyone is fully in agreement that we will keep all letters A through M, or if there's any you would like to pull out individually. All right. Go ahead, Dr. McLeod.
The superintendent recommends that the school committee move to approve the items by consensus as outlined below.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Kavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
And it's unanimous and so carries. And at this time, I would seek a motion to enter into executive session in order to comply with or act under the authority of the Mass General Law specific to the review of executive session minutes for the meetings of August 16, 2011, June 14, 2012, 1 and 2, June 20th, 2012, April 25th, 2013, June 13th, 2013, July 9th, 2013, and November 25th, 2013, December 5th, 2013, August 18th, 2014, December 22nd, 2015, and January 19th, 2017 for release. And then we will reconvene in open session for the purposes of adjournment.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Kavanaugh. This will be a roll call vote. Jean?
Yes.
Nancy?
Yes.
Kelly?
Yes.
And I'm a yes. And we will enter into executive session at 8:37.
I think for this meeting's right, February 16th. They all were.
Right. So I will just announce what our next meetings are before we run over to executive session. Because when we do come back, it's likely we will
it's not in the
be live.
School, though. It's at HCAM.
Our Thursday, February 16th meeting will be at the HCAM studios at 7 p.m. due to a conflict here in the high school library. We then have meetings on March 2nd. And March 16th here in the high school library, and then April 6th and April 13th here in the high school library. All our regular meetings at our regular scheduled time at 7 p.m. Thank you very much. All right, we will.
He doesn't have to stay, does he?
No.